It's my great pleasure to introduce today's eminent speaker, Dr. M. Lakshmi. Dr. M. Lakshmi, presently working as a professor in Department of CSE, SRM Institute of Science and Technology. She has completed PhD from Satyabhama University in the area of Wireless Ad Hoc Network and MBE from Madras University. She has an experience of more than 24 years in teaching. She previously worked as a professor in Savita University as a principal in Sri Krishna College of Technology and as a professor and dean School of Computing, Satyabhama University, Chennai. She has published more than 50 papers in international journals and conferences. Also organized many national and international conferences. She has organized many workshops to students, faculty, and research scholars. She has completed a cumulative research project funded by Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research, Kalpakkam, titled Development of Data Mining Tools for Sequencing, Assembly, Disassembly of the Fuel Transfer Arm for EFBR and Identification of Cellular Modes During the Operation. She is the DST first project coordinator and got a funding of 57 lakh from DST to establish wireless sensor and IoT lab. She has received Best Teacher Awards 5 times in the year 2003, 2007, 2009, 2012, and 2014 from Satyabhama University. I request to the madam, please take a charge and continue this session.
Thank you, Dr. Lakshmanan, for the wonderful introduction. So, I thank Chaya ma'am for giving me the opportunity. The management, the department of CSE department, for this program, because it is not easy to conduct.
Ma'am, please not. Voice is breaking. Your voice is breaking.
Voice is breaking. Yeah, once again. Then, okay, sir. I will connect through my mobile because I have some issue with my laptop speaker. Okay. I think. Okay. Okay. So while go with my. Okay. Session. Okay. Give me 2 minutes. Slide. And. I will mute my seeing the presentation and other things. Okay.
My screen is visible as well. My voice is audible.
Yes, ma'am. Clear voice is clear and PPT is visible.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Actually, now we'll see introduction to already 2 days you were all listening to various lectures on machine learning, various learning algorithms, and deep learning also. Already you have seen CNN and other things as per the schedule. So I thought of giving you introduction to deep learning as well as feed forward neural network. Okay. So what is deep learning? And how it is different from machine learning? Can anyone give me? Either you can give in chat also. How? What is the difference between machine learning and deep learning? Because deep learning has become very, very popular only nowadays, right? I have seen many FTPs, STTPs, and other things started from 2015 something. So we were into deep learning, and 2010 it started. Actually, it is not a new deep learning concept, is not new. It was there, but now we frequently use deep learning. So why we are moving on to deep learning? Anyone? Why we have not, actually you all know that artificial intelligence is the main domain where we try to incorporate the human intelligence into the machine. That is, we want to mimic our brain into the machine. That is the concept of artificial intelligence. And a subdomain of artificial intelligence is machine learning, where you will be using various algorithms like supervised, unsupervised, reinforced, and semi-supervised, all these algorithms, and you try to make your machine to learn by yourself, right? That is machine learning. And you may be understanding at this point that deep learning is again a subset of machine learning. We are going to deep learning? Why not machine learning? What is the drawback in machine learning? Someone has given the chat. When we have to perform complex computation and processing, then we... Very good. When we have to perform complex computation and processing, then we are moving to deep learning. That is one very good. Who has given that? So Dr. Vikas, good. And one more thing is, this is one way. So you can do massive calculation. If you want to do massive computation, your machine learning has some restrictions. So we are moving on to deep learning. And another thing is, in machine learning, you have to give all the features by yourself, right? You need to do the feature extraction. And if any problem, you can solve it properly only when the feature extraction phase is good. If we are not able to extract the features, then your whatever may be, if it is a classification problem, you will not be able to classify, right? So that was the major problem. But in deep learning, the problem is solved, because you give just the input data, your deep neural network itself will try to learn. Right? That is the major difference in deep learning. So why people are moving, not only to solve the complex problem, it has the capability to learn the patterns by itself, right? Even though, if for example, if you want to categorize between different fruits, right? And if you leave out some minute features, then it is not possible for you to differentiate between certain fruit, right? Which are very similar. So the minute feature needs to be captured, and that has to be fed in to train your neural network. That was the case in machine learning. But in case of deep learning, from the data itself, because you have multiple layers, from the deep data itself, it tries to learn and it tries to capture the features, right? So that is a major thing, right? So deep learning, this is the definition given by Wikipedia. Deep learning is a branch of machine learning based on set of algorithm that attempt to model high level abstractions, right? That is a high level, that is what I told. The minor features are also can be captured, and as well the major features can also be captured, right? So high level abstraction in the data by using multiprocessing, that is multiple processing layers with complex structure. That as Vikas told, complex structure can define complex activation functions and so on, so that the categorization is better. So otherwise composed of multiple nonlinear transformation. So why we are going to deep learning is because of high level abstraction, and because it has the ability to learn the pattern by itself. So actually, is it new? No, it is not new. This slide shows that the deep neural network came very early, but now only we are started. Everything is in way back in 1970s to 80 itself it was formed, but now only we are using it. Why now we are, so before going we are using the is one of them to recognize but I need to capture related to a even though it is learning algorithm comes into picture, because I took sorry, they had some problem. Once again. Okay. Here, the one layer, that is the lowermost layer, like the lines, edges, and corners, everything. It tries to levels of layer. It tries to identify the middle level features like eyes, features, side view of the face, advantage. Why we are going for deep learning is hand it is possible for us to have a large data set, and the large, initially it is not possible to store the large data set because we have it poor other things and we were able to collect even all the unstructured data as well for processing. That is possible. And next is we have a very good hardware support like GPU. Even though if you are not owning the GPU also, you can, right? Like you have certain tools. Google has provided Google Colab, right, where you can use a virtual machine, right? Virtual GPU can be used and you can process the wherever you want, high large computing, wherever you in CPU the computation may take 3 or 4 days to complete, where the GPU can make it very fast because of this massively parallelizable characteristic of it, right? So that is possible, and you need not have your own GPUs. You can use the GPUs available in the cloud, right? So many are providing that even your lab like software, these are all providing for research and education purpose, right? And same way, the software, we have very good software tools available like TensorFlow, PyTorch, and other things which can do massive computation parallelly. So all this, because of all this, now deep learning has become so not only because of its processing, because we have very good processing hardware, we have very good storage, we have very good software tool to compute. Now we are using it to solve a major many complex problem. So I will see how to the neural network. I thought I want to give the insight. So first, what is perceptron? And you know, the perceptron is a building block of a deep learning network, right? So this is a perceptron where and if anybody is having any difficulty, you can either you can inform me or you can send the chat, right? So here you have many inputs and then weights. This is all everybody know, right? This is how you build a neural network, and this is a single perceptron, and you know this is a output neuron. So the output neuron does two major thing. One is the weighted sum. It calculates the weighted sum. As well, it calculates, it performs an activation function. I have put these two as a plate, but these two will be done in the output neuron. So actually, what happens in the output neuron, everybody know, here I have some, actually what, it multiplies the input with the weight, and all the weighted all the inputs multiplied with the corresponding weight is added together. That is what happens here, and then you will be performing an activation function. This activation function is to normalized. For that, we will be using an activation function, and this activation function can be linear or non-linear. If we have a simple problem, linear activation function itself is enough. But nowadays, we are using deep neural network to solve a complex problem. In that case, we need to have a non-linear activation function. We'll see later what all the non-linear activation functions we have, and then after activation, you will be getting output, right? So this is what is happening here inside this summation, this particular output neuron. And so you will be getting Y hat. Y hat is nothing but Y. Actually, the output is called always as Y, but Y we are mentioning is Y hat. Is this Y hat is the calculated output, right? And Y is the actual output. And always there will be a difference between these two, because to make these two only equal, we are making, we are training the this perceptron, right? We are trying to train this, right? So here this is what your Y hat. So you hear it, this is the activation function, and this is a linear combination of input, right? So Xi into Y, that is what is happening. So all you know, so just for refreshing, I am giving it here again. And One more thing will be added to make the learning adding a bias. So for each and every input neuron, along with the weights, a bias will also be given, right? That is the concept of perceptron. And all this is actually the famous observation. So the activation function having here, this will be applied here. So I will be getting output. These output will vary between 0 and 1 mostly. Right? The common activation function, one is sigma, another one is hyperbolic agent, and this is the activation function for we are just going to use these five. These are all already available, right? These are all we are just going to use this activation functionly, and this is used in many of these activation functions. Non-linear, right? So what is the need to have a non-linear now, right? So here, if we have a problem like this, parameter is along the x-axis, this may be any problem. The problem is not defined, only the parameters with respect to x and y value is given. And here, the red dot that belongs to a binary class classification, where we have two class, all the red points may be to zero, all the green points, the output of the activation function needed is one, right? So if we want to distinguish between these two, then it is not easy to have a linear function, right? If we have a linear function, what happens is the linear function will just it will try to segregate like only by a straight line, right? The line can be anything, but that by drawing lines, it is not possible to because what we need is we need a separation like this, where all green points comes and together and all the red points. So that is not possible by using linear. That's why we are going for non-linear function. So that is what is shown here. We need to have a functionality like this, right? If we are going to use a perceptron, it is not possible to have a non-linear function. That is not, even though you use a non-linear activation function here, right? Even though the activation function which you are using is non-linear, but a single perceptron is not possible to give a complex function, right? It is not able to classify the complex function. So we will take this example where we have two input, x1, x2, and the weights are defined as 3 and minus 2, and bias is 1. And so when you try to calculate the value, so this is what we'll be getting, y hat is the predicted output. So the predicted output is equal to activation function, right? This activation function of 1 plus 3 into x1, that is x1 into weight, that is x1 into 3 minus 2 into x2. So that is what is given here. One is by R. So this, when you, just by seeing this, you can tell that this is a line in it to the space, right? So this is what you, if you plot, you will be getting like this. And if you take any point in this, for example, I'm taking minus 1 and 2, right? That is x1 is minus 1 and x2 is 2. These are the two values. If I'm substituting in this, I'm getting minus 6, and apply the activation function here where we are using sigmoid activation function. You know, sigmoid activation function is nothing but it is, what is sigmoid activation function? Anyone? 1 by 1 plus 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power minus x, right? Or e to the power minus z, right? We'll take this as z. This is z. Whatever we have within g, that is z, right? So e to the power minus 6. When you substitute here in the place of z, when you substitute minus 6, then what we'll be getting is, we'll be getting approximately 0.024 something, so which is approximated to 0.002. Right? So this is what we'll be getting. And what this tells us, so here, if this value is less than 0.5, then the, actually, if it is less than 0.5, it lies in this, if it is less than 0.5, and if z is greater than 0 value, then it lies in this particular, so above this line, right? So it will be lying here. Please wait 2 minutes. So actually it lies this side, right? So, sorry, something happened. One second. My screen is visible. So if the value is, so if I have y value greater than 0, then the points will be equal to, then it like this point where z will be equal to 0.5. And this, equation is equal to 0. So I can use this simple the perceptron only for linear classification. I cannot use it for the binary classification. Only for linear classification if single neuron is used. But sigmoid can be applied. It is a complex activation function only. So here what we are going to use throughout our learning, this is our learning algorithm. So what is this learning algorithm? Can anyone tell me by saying this? You can put it in the chat. WT plus 1 is equal, that is actually what we are doing is, we are doing weight and we are doing the differentiation of weight and bias, that is back propagation. Right, so first two statement is for forward pass, and second two statement is, what is this actually? Have you heard of gradient descent? I'm not able to write with mobile. So actually, this is a gradient descent algorithm, right? Where this these weight adjustments are done by actually, so the difference between the weight and the differentiation of it, that is the activation of this one, that is gradient of weight, right? So actually, what we are doing is we are trying to adjust the weight, and we are moving away from the gradient. Gradient means always it gives a greater value. We will try to move away from the gradient so that we will try to minimize the loss, right? So the gradient is a we are using the loss, right? So how to achieve minima so that always the last value will be what is all this thing, right? Example here, where so let us hit x2 and x1 is plotted, and here this is this is a particular person. He wants to purchase a mobile phone, and he want to purchase a mobile phone whose screen size is from 3.5 inches to 4.5, right? He wanted within this limit is the mobile, as well as the cost should not okay, right? Because we are not taking any other features of the mobile phone like its RAM and other capacities we are not taking, but we are taking only two parameters, and it is plotted against these two parameters. And this is some real world example. So the cost of the mobile phone across x and y, where x1 in the x-axis, that is x1 is the size of the screen, and x2 is where the interested feature, right? That is, for example, I'm interested to purchase mobile phone within this range, 8 to 12K, and free size of this is this particular one. Then my concern, my required area is middle one, right? So in a particular mobile features, testing the other features, I can select, right? And these are the points outside. These are all, for example, if I take any one particular point here, any particular point here, here size of screen is less than 3.5 and cost is also. So this the screen is less than, and since the cost is high, I may not be, this mobile phone may not be having lot of features, so I'm not interested. And if I take point here, two mobiles, right? So the screen size is very 12K. Even my budget is 12K. But I don't want a mobile which is of a high, very big screen. For example, if this is somewhere around 6, I don't want a 6-inch size or any size standardized. I don't know that. So I don't want a bigger screen apart from 4.5. I'm interested only the screen size 3.5 to 4.5 inches, then cost. My affordable cost is only up to 12K. I'm when you go low, the mobile phone will not be good. That's my idea. So I have a region. Then, point, right? So how to build that particular thing, that is how we are
हेलो 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 मैडम हेलो
I'm very sorry, because of severe rain here, the network is getting. Sorry, I went out unknowingly, right? So we'll come back. So actually here, this is what I'm interested only this, right? We'll see how to make a complex function, right? So with the single neuron, if I tried, so this is what my interest. So with the single neuron, I will not be able to, because if I want to segregate, I need a function like this, right? Which will get the input here, right? So this is what is shown, right? So what this diagram shows is when I plot it against a three-dimensional, this is with respect to output, and this is the cost, and this is the screen. So here I need all the values for this particular point, right? All the values should be one, right? And all the other places, right? So whatever we see here,
hello?
In the, that is, yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Hello.
Ma'am, is am I audible?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Hello. Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, your voice is clear.
No, somebody is calling. Hello, that's why. Okay. Right. So here, these are all the points where the output needs to be zero, right? So my area, this one is this one, right? We'll see how to, what type of neural network I need to use here, right? So if I'm, that is what, actually here, so here, this is not, which is very, this is not continuous function. So this, like this, we need a continuous function. So in this continuous function, you can see that these points are all right wherever. So here, when the other places, it is zero. So here, this particular this thing alone is one, right? This is our for this we need to build a this, okay, neural network. So you all know that y hat, that is the predicted output, is nothing but it is a function of x1 and x2, where x1 is the screen size and x2 is the cost, right? So when you try to predict, and if you are using the perceptron, we'll see how the perceptron is not possible, because if you are taking two inputs x1, x2, and weight, and this is the activation function. Y hat is nothing but here what I am using is, I am using a sigmoid activation function. So this is how, that is 1 by 1 plus divided by 1 plus e to the power minus minus z. Z is nothing but the weighted sum here along with the BIOS. So when we try this one, then it is not possible to have get a continuous function like this. This is not possible because the sigmoid is nothing but it will be like this, right? So you will be having, sorry, you will be having the function like this only. Right, right. So if you try to turn, maybe it may become like this, but it you can never get a complex function like this. That is not possible. We'll see the same example. So this is how when these are all the weights taken, W1 is zero, W2 is minus, and BIOS is kept as zero. So this is the plane, right? So the yellow color tells that the values either are all one, and the values flat is nothing but zero. So what happens is these blue points are considered, example, all the red points should be one and all the green blue points should be zero. But here if you see, these blue points comes under one category for this particular weight and BIOS, and remaining all is plotted as zero, right? You will be getting zero for all the other inputs, right? You can apply any input and you can check one, all the other values. So it is wrongly, right? So when I change in the weight and BIOS, I'm not able to come out with a proper this one, right? So always what I'm getting is I'm getting some other wrong value, right? So these are all becoming one, then leaving the other are all zero. So that is the problem. So what we are going to do is we are going to, so even for BIOS 90, so this red points is plotted one, along with that this blue is also plotted with one, right? Do you understand? So this is a three dimensional plane. So the all these yellow, this one is one, and here this particular this thing is what, all are zero, right? So these is the totally all these are all plotted to be one, but our expectation is only the red point should be, the activation function output should be one, and for the this one it should be zero. But here, since we are using single perceptron, it is not able to discriminate the complex function. That's why we are going in for deep neural network. So how to build a deep neural network, right? So this is like constructing a house, right? How you will construct a house, the basic building for block for constructing a house is nothing but brick, right? Brick and sand and cement, other things, right? So we'll take a brick as a basic building block, right? So you will be building a house, depends upon the space available, depends upon the type of house you want, depends upon the model, and depends upon all these things. You will be building a different houses, right? You can see different houses. All the houses are not similar, even though the construction block used is bricks and cement and other things, right? So here also we are going to build neural network which tries to solve the complex problem, where all the neural networks uses perceptron as the fundamental building block, right? By using perceptron as the fundamental block, based on the complexity of the problem, you may be having different layers of neurons which connects with each other, and each layer, the number of neurons varies and number of layers also varies, right? And you all know that your neural network has an input layer and multiple hidden layers and then the output layer. And the number of neurons in the hidden layers and the number of neurons in the output layer all varies, depends upon the problem, right? So how to tune, how to identify how many layers I want, how to identify all this, that is called as hyperparameter tuning. So hyperparameter tuning is very, very important. We'll see how that can be done in the later part of our lecture, right? How hyperparameter tuning goes work, right? So this is your perceptron, and here this is a simplified one. So this will be acting as a building block. So here this is multi-output perceptron, where you have two outputs. This where you will be using is this type of network. You may be use this. Actually, this is an input layer, and this is a hidden layer or output layer, where you have two neurons at the output layer, mostly for binary classification, where you have two outputs. And for binary classification, you can also use single output, because your binary classification is to classify. So see, we have seen our previous example, the mobile phone purchase example, where I will be either purchasing or I will not be having purchasing, right? These are all the two things. Right. So there I can have a single, if I have different classes, for example, I'm going to segregate between, for example, set of fruits, apple and orange. In that case, it is, I can use two classes, or this can be multi-class also, right? If there are multiple classes, for example, four neurons at the output layer, then, so this is a multi-output perceptron. And this again here, multi-output perceptron, if you see, these are all the input neurons are connected with the all the output neurons. So this is called as dense layer, because all inputs are densely connected to all the outputs. Not only all the outputs, for all the hidden layers also, all these happens, right? So this is called as dense layer. And this is a single layer neural network, where you have input layer, output layer, and one hidden layer, right? Your hidden layer is one. And how you will be calculating the hidden layer is nothing but input into W1. So same as your output, right? Input into W1. Actually, here, if you take all the neurons, hidden neuron or the output neuron, it does two main functions. One is just it calculates, right? We can divide it as a two part. This side, it calculates the weighted sum. And here, it does the activation function, right? So it calculates the weighted sum, let it be Z, activation function. And once it activated, we'll be calling it as H. Output as H, or you, that is here it is but weighted sum, and when you apply a activation function, it becomes G of Z1, which is given as an input to the output layer, right? So that is what happens in the Z layer, right? And then final output Y hat is nothing but the weighted sum of all the Y hat 1, Y hat I is whatever we are getting here, right? From Z1, from that is G of Z1 into W2, G of Z2 into W2, G of Z2 into W3, G of Z4 into W4, right? W24. So we'll be calling this as W21, that is second layer weight 1, and this is W22, W23, like that, right? So we'll be calling, and then all this, that activation function, again here you will be performing some activation function to get the Y hat 1 and Y hat 2. So this is how the final output, right? So this is input and hidden, this is how the hidden computation happens, right? And the output computation, right? Hope it's clear. So this is shown as a breakup. So what happens, how is it to inputs are calculated, right? So whatever is coming to Z2, here it is calculating the weighted sum. That is, this is a bias, right? This is bias. And then X1, W1, 2, where 1 is nothing but the first, this tells the this particular neuron, and then this is the next layer neuron, that is 2. And here this is 2, 2, and that is current layer, and the next layer, M, 2, right? So this is how it is calculating, and then it is performing the activation function, and that is given as output to the next layer, right? So this is multi-output perceptron, where we have multiple layers. So here we are not bothered about this one, right? So this is kept as a black box. So input, hidden, output. This is a single hidden layer. We have single hidden layer. So when you talk about deep neural network, we'll be having multiple hidden layers. Only one is shown here. Likewise, we'll be having multiple hidden layers, where this black box is nothing but the connection between the previous layer and the connection between the next layer, and including weights, right? So this is for understanding, I have given like this, right? Now we'll see how to, so here we saw, it is trying to solve this. I want to select a mobile within 3.5 inches and the cost between 8. So it is not able to segregate by able to, it is not able to perform linearity here, right? So that is why we are the. Yes, here W11 is nothing but using laptop for presenting and my phone for please don't unmute my so this is for the someone is unmuting my so that I'm going out and again I'm coming in. So now we'll continue. So this is okay. So here the weights are given here W1 input 2 to first node. That is here it is given as 1, 2. First one tells the next layer neuron. That is this is next layer, hidden layer neuron. And 2 is nothing but the current one is 2, right? And here W1, 3. So this is next layer 1 and this is bias. Sorry, this is bias. So here that is this is 1, 3 and this is 1, 4. Here we are using different numbers. W11, 12, 13, 14 for the weights and X1, X2 and B1 for B1 is a bias for this particular neuron and B2 is a bias for this particular neuron. So BT, B2 is for this and B1 is for this and B3 is for this particular neuron. So how we'll be calculating the output is nothing but so here H1. First, we need to, if we want to go to the output, first we need to know what will be the hidden layer. So, hidden layer, we have this one can be considered as H1. So, H1 is nothing but function of function 1, that is any activation function 1 of X1, X2, and this is H2. H2 is nothing but again the function. This may need not be the same activation function. We can use different function also. So that's why if F2 is given, and that is again a function of X1, X2, as well as weights and bias, all this. And Y hat is nothing but the activation function, because these two are given as input here. So this is nothing but Y hat is equal to activation function of H1, H2. So H1, H2, which is the output of this particular neuron that is given, that is hidden layer output is input to the output layer, right? So this, so how the calculation will be here? Here, what we are using is we are using sigmoid activation function. So since we are using sigmoid activation function, we know that 1/1 e^-z, where this is root to x2 plus b1. That is what is given here. e^-raised to power like this, right? W11 into x1, W12 into x2 plus bias, right? So this is what is done for all these things. And this is your final y hat. What is y hat? Y hat is nothing but here it is, the entire, all these put together, h1, h2, that is what is shown here. Right? So this is e^ minus W, the W one, and all the values of one here. The thing is, it's to the power of E. This one, W two, W. This one, H two, H two is thing, but this one, 1/1 all these values. So that is what plus, so you can see a more complex function here, right? So you were out, and somewhere this network converges at this particular value of this W11, W12, W13, 4 and all these weights 21 and 22, and bias 1, bias 2 is kept as 0. So you, here you can see, so here you can see at most all these points comes under 1, right? And all these points are considered to be 0, right? So somewhere we were trying to converge or try to have a complex function which segregates this red points from the blue points. So this particular weights, right, you can also try, right, this taking this and you can try whether it is con, so may not be this particular neural network, right? I have taken two hidden layers and one output layer, and I have used the same sigmoid function, and then I try to converge my this one, right, by with this particular set of weights. Actually, this set of weights I have arranged by after giving multiple weights, right? So I have put only the final thing here. So we, you can, so this is what, right? So this is how you will be building the complex deep neural network, right? So here again, the problem is how I know that I should select this particular network. How do I know that I need two hidden layer and one output layer? And because I know the input only two features, X1, H2, that is the screen size and the cost. But the number of layer in the hidden layers and the output layer maybe one, because it is a binary classification. I have only two classification, right? Whether I'm going to purchase a mobile or I'm not going to purchase a mobile. So if the any value within this particular thing, I will be purchasing any value outside. That is the whatever value I'm giving in the blue points, I will not be purchasing. I'll be purchasing anyone. So for this, it gives 0, 1, or 0. So this here, this is correct. But how to select this one? That is a major thing. How many layers, right? It need not be single layer. I can have multiple layer also. So how to do all these things? This comes out of the experience, right? So we have many things. The how to identify the number of layers, how to identify number of neurons in each hidden layer, all these things are called as hyperparameter tuning. So that is a very big part of research, how to tune your network, how to identify all these things. We'll see that later, right? So this is what has happened. Now we'll see the terminologies of deep neural network. So I have taken a wide and deep network where I have a three inputs, x1, x2, x3. And we can see bias b1, b2, b3 given to each and every layer. So here, this is an L layer network where I will be having L minus one hidden layer, right? If your network is L layer network, then the Lth layer will be the output layer, right? Lth layer will be the output layer, and remaining L minus one layer will be the hidden layer, right? This will be L minus one. And here, L defines the number of layers and number of neurons in each layer that can be defined separately, right? I can have the same number of neurons in all the layers, or I can have different number of neurons in the hidden layer. That is depends upon the problem. It varies, right? So now we'll see some of the terminologies. So the pre-activation at layer I, that is any hidden layer. So how the pre-activation? Pre-activation is nothing but the total weighted sum along with the bias. That is called as pre-activation. And we'll be referring the pre-activation with the value A1. Previously, we used Z. So here I'm using A1. And H1 is nothing but post-activation. That is after activation, whatever I'm getting. So the activation function can be a sigmoid, or it can be a softmax function, or it can be a ReLU function, right? So this is any layer. This is how you will be calculating, that is weight into the previous layer's input, right? So if this is the layer 2, this is, let us assume this is layer 2, right? I will be taking, how I will be calculating A2 is, A2 is nothing but weight 2, 1, 1, right? Weight 2, that is layer 2, 1, 1 is nothing but from the first neuron to the first neuron of this one. So I will be writing like this, W2, double one. One is for this layer, and this is another one is for this one. Here I will be, this weight is nothing but H2 into W2, 1, 2, right? So like that, it will be calculating. That is what is shown here. That is, it is shown as H minus one, right? And next is the activation layer is given by, and then after that, this is pre-activation. The activation is nothing but just apply the activation function all with respect to X, right? And next is the output layer. So the output layer, how will you calculate is the HL. HL is nothing but it is Y hat. Y hat is equal to the activation function of AL. Everything put together, right? All the pre-activated values of that particular layer, right? That's what here it is given as L. L is nothing but the last layer, that is your output layer, and hidden layers you will be considering as L minus one layer. So this is a simple example where we have here, even though three inputs are given, so here we are taking 10 inputs. Where we are taking 100 inputs, right? 100 inputs, and then here x1 to x100 is the input, and here hidden layer, what we'll be having is we are having 10 neurons in the hidden layer, right? So here it is 10 neurons, and here the input is 100 input, right? So even though 3 is shown, we have many multiple inputs up to x100. So this is how the weight matrix will be. W11, so actually this I put, I have to show the difference. What is W11 is nothing but the first one tells the number of layer, right? This is nothing but which layer it belongs to, right? Whether it is belonging to layer 1 or layer 2. This is layer 1, this is layer 2. So which layer? This particular layer, it is given as W1. And this 1, 2 is nothing but 1 is this particular node, and 2 is, sorry, 1 is the next layer node, right? The next layer node is this one, right? So this is 1. Here, if I am going to apply all the weight, so what I will be having is here, this will be W11, and this will be W12, like that, right? Some notations I will be using, that is what is shown here. So this is what this is how it is calculating. So here you can see AW1 is nothing but AW. So W1, am I audible?
Yes,
you are
audible.
Okay. So W1, and then this is nothing but the previous network, and this is the current. Okay, so here, sorry, this is the next layer. The second number is next layer, that is this one, A1, and then this big, from here it will be W12, like that it goes, right? So you will be calculating the second layer activation function, that is pre-activation values. A1112 is the pre-activation layer, like that we'll be calculating. And this is what is the abstract thing. A1 is nothing but weight into input plus bias. That is what is done here, right? A1 is equal to, that is, we'll take everything as A1. All the pre-activation values of this particular layer one as A1. A1 is, this is nothing but A11. This is A12. This is A13. Right, so all these as the values. So that is what is calculated here. Since we have 10 neurons here, we have up to 10. I told it is 10 neurons. So 10. So this is nothing but A1 W1. So this is how this is calculated as a vector weighted sum. When you apply the activation function, this is nothing but sigmoid activation function of A1. And this is how it's given for M neurons. So we have two hidden layer with each M neurons and then output. So you'll be similarly, whatever is performed here for the first layer, the same thing is applicable to the second layer also. So they will be calculating the pre-activation function A2 here. So here this is A21, A22, A23. So A2 I will be calculating is W2 into H1 plus B1. That is second bias and then activation function. So till all the hidden layers, we have shown only two hidden layers. If there are n hidden layers, for all the hidden layers, this is how the pre-activation and then activation function is calculated, right? Hope it's clear. Now we'll see how to calculate the output, right? So output, again, the same thing, right? So here it is not necessary that even though we have M neurons in the hidden layer, it is not necessary. Here we have taken MM. It can be M, it can be N, and the output can be K, right? So always the output and input hidden layer need not be the same. It is the K depends upon the type of the problem, right? For example, if you are using for classification problem, if it is a multi-class classifier, then if there are floor classification, then we'll be having 4 output neurons. If it is a binary classification, instead of 2, I'll be having 1. Or I can have 2 also. 1 is always give positive, another will give negative, or 1 will be always 0, another 1 will be 1, right? So this is how I'll be. So the output depends upon always a particular task, right? So still I'll be calculating like this. A3 is equal to W3 into H2. That is the previous layer. Previous layer is the last hidden layer. All the activation function activated value with weights I'll be calculating along with the bias. And then again, I will be applying an activation function. Excuse me. So here, this is how your y hat happens. So here, y hat is equal to, this is the function, y hat is equal to. So actually, what is given shown here is the final predicted output, right? So I hope this is clear. So it is nothing but, you can see, this is the input layer. From the input layer, input to the hidden layer, you are calculating the activation function. This is for input, and this is for the, so actually this is A1, right? This is A1 and this is nothing but H1, and this is A2. So this is A2, and everything, when you apply an activation function, this gives H2, and this is your output, right? So this is your A3, up to this is A3, and when you apply the activation function, this becomes Y hat. Hope it is clear, right? So I think that I will stop here and we will have a 10 minutes break. Okay, ma'am? Chaya, ma'am?
Okay, madam. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
So we will meet after 10 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Hope if you have any doubts, you please leave it in the chat box. After that, when I come back, I will clarify your doubt, right? So I'll stop here. Okay.
Okay. We will meet at 10:35.
10:30. Okay, 11:35 we'll meet. Thank you.
Sorry, 11:35. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Yes, good afternoon. Shall we resume back?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
We stop here. We'll continue.
Yes, yes, madam.
So, game activation function. Whether we are being so, whether we are being this is what we are going to see. Yeah, with all the other yes, I have. What sigmoid function? So we have to decide, right? So sigmoid always, it can be anything, it can be either smack relu or whatever it is, depends upon the see how we are going to take here a network. You can see this neural network was built for multi-class classification, right? I have given two example. One has first the neural network, which is right, that is an apple output I'll be having. This is the actual value. Then I need to get only ma'am, again and request kindly don't unmute myself.
Okay.
Right?
Okay. Okay.
My laptop is unmute.
Okay.
Only my mobile line because please mute. One second. Sorry. Okay. So this is what we were seeing. So here our output is not a single output, it is a vector, right, which has four values, and the first value tells whether whatever input I have given is an apple or not. The second will tell whether it is a banana. So if it is a banana, all the other values will be zero, only the second value will be one. If it is orange, all keeping zero, this needs to be one. And grape, for grape, I'll be having 0, 0, 1. So that is what. So here, by seeing it is a, actually, we can call binary classification also multi-class classification, where it has only two classes. But in case of multiple class, it has multiple, more than two classes, right? So here, this is how the activation function two hidden layer, and the activation, how to calculate, and the activation. That's what we saw so far in the lecture before the break. Okay, and this is another this one which takes the film. Whether the output is again a multi-class where it gives different ratings, right? So here, if you take this, right, XI is the features. So multiple features are given. So whether the director and then actor, all the details, whatever details, and it is classifying the rating. It is giving IMDb rating, and it is critic rating, and this is RT, Rotten Tomato rating, and box office collection. What is the collection? So here, if you see this, this is not multi-class, right? So this is not multi-class because here this is rating, and here you can see it gives a rating. It, instead of giving zeros and ones, it is application. This is for regression, where you will be having multiple values, right? So where you are getting the one output tells what is the box office collection, and the other output tell gives the rating for the film by a different people or different domain, like IMDb critics. This is a critic rating, and this is a Rotten Tomato rating. So this is a regression. So I'm not going to deal regression now. We are going to deal only the classification, right? Multi-class classification. So here we'll take this example. And here, if this is the true input, right? So here I need to, the input given is Apple. So I need this output, right? One, all the other things are zero. But my predicted output for some input, I don't know, I have given some input here. So for that input, actually Apple, I am taking five features, right? That five features is given as input. For that particular input, my predicted output is this one, right? So Apple, I'm getting 0.64. And for the remaining things, this is 0.03, 0.26, 0.07. Okay. So for this, right, so I need to predict it properly. So what kind of activation function should I use, right? That is what my query is at this point. So here, if I'm giving this as weights, based on this, this is the weight and this is the activation. H2 is the activation function. So here, this is actually, we are talking about the output layer. So A3. The W3 is given, and that is H2 is nothing but the previous layer, right? Here we are considering 10 layers. That is what 10 inputs is given. And here weight is, that is here again, we have a 10 cross 10 matrix here, right? So this is also 10. So how this calculates the A3, right? Now I'm going to apply this Y hat, some function I'm going to apply, right? So what function is comfortable for this? So for example, if I'm taking A3 value as 3, 4, 10, and 3, that is whatever I'm getting here, right? Whatever I'm getting here, this value, since 4 neuron, the output of 4 neuron is some real number, 3, 4, because why this is not in points, because I'm not applying activation function. Once you apply activation function, your values will always lie between 0 and 1. Since I have not applied the activation function, I am getting some real values, 3, 4, 10. So here, probability thing, so has to be chosen such that the output is a probability. So what I'm doing is I'm taking this value on total probability. So 3 divided by 3 plus 4 plus 10 plus, that is a total sum of the output divided by 3. So if I'm calculating the probability of occurring 3 for the first input, probability of occurring 4 for the second input, and third and fourth, I'll be getting 0.15, 0.20, 0.50. So actually, if you check the total, all will be summed up to 1, right? All will be summing up to 1. So this is what is expected, right? So if you take the probability for this expected a value, then my probability, all the probability value should count to 1. That is what is expected, right? So if now we'll take the same thing and we are going to apply the same probability for this particular value, 7 minus 2, 4, 1. So actually here negative input is given. Negative is possible because we will be getting some real values, right? So that is possible. So when you calculate the same thing, here again, if you see, hope I am audible.
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Yeah. So here, if you see the here again, you have got 1. This all this, if you add, it will be leading to 1. But if you take the probability, we are talking about probability, and you have never heard of anything, the probable outcome to be negative. The probability output will be either between 0 to 1, any value between 0 to 1, not less than 0 or not greater than 1, right? So here if you see, it is less than 0 and this should not happen. So when we use sigmoid function at the output, right, in case of multi-class classifier, if you are using sigmoid function, what happens is if there is a negative value, and then your activation function will also give negative, that should be avoided, right? So the output should be any value between, because we are talking about the probability. So the probability should always total to be 1, and it should not be a negative value. Hope you all understand what I am trying to explain. Right, so that's why it is not possible to use. So we are going to apply. So at the output layer, only in the output layer, that too for multi-class classification, if you use a sigmoid function at the output layer, the problem is sometimes if any negative value comes, you will be getting negative output, which should not be the case, right? So always if you have a value, if you add all the values, that is, if you get a predicted value, if you add all the predicted value, it should be always equal to 1. It should not be equal to, or it should not be, in negative value should not be there, right? So that should be taken into consideration. That's why we are going for softmax function at the output. And this is how we will be defining the softmax, e to the power zi divided by the total summation of and j is equal to 1 to k, that is summation of all the e rise is the activation function. Right. So this is how we'll be calculating the softmax, and why we are going for softmax is this one. So y is equal to x. Value is 0 or it is summed to the negative zone, right? Right, it is always kept power x, e rise x always will be, value is negative, the value is positive. That's why we are going. Playing softmax at the output, and this is what you will be getting, and softmax output, right? So here you can now hope it's clear. So the input, that is the first layer, your activation function, you are using sigmoid activation function. Output layer, this is output layer. Output layer is, I have given here. So this is for output layer. So output layer, we are calculating as like the other one, but we are applying softmax function. Okay. So why we are applying softmax function? To avoid negativity in the output, right? So how to deal with extreme non-linearity? So for example, If you are having only two inputs, then by seeing the data, we can identify how the nonlinearity function will be. That just this shows how this region will be. This region is all one and this region is zero, right? So this is easily classifiable. And if I have a zeros and outer circle all ones, this is one other way. So if it is a two-dimensional data, I can plot the values and I can see how my classifier should be. What the classification should be, that I can visualize, right? So if for two features, I can visualize. But if the dimensionality increase for X3, even for theta, and I can see how my classifier looks like, right? So here, this one blue all or should be this. So it's easy to classify, it is visualize how my pair should be. But if dimensionality increases, if the input is 4, 5, 6, 7, then I will not be able to visualize how my action should be. How major query. So I can resolve by having different type of neural network, a deep neural network. So here I have given four and see how so here we have the tools. Which network to I have and I have select this one. Sorry, loss. Right. So I have. Conclusion that type of so I will be. Neural network parameter is not experience computer tuning depends on and number of neurons in each layer and what is the learning rate. We have not seen learning rate so far, But when you use gradient descent algorithm, there you will be using the learning rate. So what learning rate we are going to apply and what optimization function, right, or what optimization algorithm we are using to optimize our loss, right? All this depends upon all these parameters you will be selecting a neural network, right? So I have this along with the loss, not only so even tuning on all these of neurons in each and the optimization algorithm and as well as the size of this I will be deciding. One second. So based on all these things we'll be selecting, right? And here how this parameter tuning has to be done, right? So now we will recall the machine learning pyramid. So in the machine learning pyramid, if you see, the lower thing is data engineer. The task of data engineer is the data engineer will be specifying, will be defining the data and defining the task for the data, right? So that is defined. So this is a low level features. Data engineer defines the low level features. And next comes the ML engineer. So these ML engineers defines the hyperparameter tuning. The major job of ML engineer is in the hyper or ML or data DLL engineer or a deep neural network, a DNN engineer, deep learning network engineer's job is to perform the hyperparameter tuning. So this is based on the research and other thing. So how to perform, it is not necessary that you need to take thousands of network and then fine tune. So based on the literature, based on the output, you can select few networks and you can try your input on that and you can identify which is the best network which is available for you, because it is not easy to identify how many layers I need to have for a particular problem, how many nodes in each layer that has to become through the experimentation and other things, right? So that is called as hyperparameter tuning. And the we are not concentrating how it is done here. That is it is a big area of research, and that is what the ML engineers does. And above that, we have researchers. Researchers or the students are overall working on. So they will be getting the guidance by the ML engineers, and they will be doing it, right? So hope how to deal with extreme linearity, this one, right? So now, so far we have seen how to select a network, right? And we have not seen how to train our network, right? So training is very, very important. Where you try to, what happens in training is you try to converge your network, right? What is meant by convergence is you will try to minimize the loss. So loss plays a major major role in training your machine learning, or your neural network or a deep neural network, whatever it is. So that is very important. So now we are going to see the loss function for two things. One is for binary classification. Another one is for machine learning, for a multi-class classification, right? So here, loss, how to calculate the loss. This is the network I have taken and I have X inputs, and then this is four neurons in the this one, and then here we have one output neuron. Since it is binary classification, one output neuron, right? So here, you can have this bias value. It's given as B1, B2 bias. It's given here. And here you can see that so here we have you can see this is a 4x4 matrix. Please, right? See how let us assume this as a training data. For those, I need one eight. Exactly. So this is what this is four. Sorry, 1x4 matrix. We have 1 row and 4, right? 4x4 with 4x1. What happens? We'll be getting 4x1. That is here. And then when you apply the sigmoid function, we'll be getting for this value. We are applying sigmoid. That is 1/1. Plus e to the power minus 0.8. So for that we are getting 0.69, 0.63, 0.67, and 0.6. So this is what the activation function, and this is A2, and because A2 we have value, I'm getting 0.948. Expert output is here. I'm getting 0.9. To perform the Asian function, but my so it's a little bit, but I need to make this as 1. My hat should be equal to 1. So what I have to do is I have to calculate the loss. So I am using cross entropy loss is represented by L of theta, which is equal to minus log of y hat if y is equal to 1. If y is equal to 0, then it is minus log of 1 minus. So here the actual value. So I'll be applying minus log of y hat. So when I apply log minus log of y hat, I'm this 0.7 is the value in this. We have so how we are going to seeing forward pass, right? And you calculate. So you are calculating A1 and you are calculating H1 and you are calculating the output, right? So you are keep on moving in the forward direction. So whatever you have done so far, this is called as forward pass, right? Sorry. So we are moving towards the forward, right? That is forward pass. And once you calculated the loss, then what we have to do is we have to do the backward pass, right? And we have to adjust the weights such that next time when you do the forward pass, your loss should be minimized or it should become equal to 0. It should be approximately equal to 0 or it should reduce 0, right? So when you, that is called as back propagation, right? So in the gradient, the learning curve are used. Backward pass is nothing but if you are using Python, let's see, weight gradient. The weight gradient automatically calculated and you can easily update the weights by using this one, right? So you need not but if you are applying the back, so we are calculating loss, how we are back propagating under afternoon, right? So here this is for by again the same thing with the some other value, right? Here we are taking another value, and for that the expected output is zero. The actual output is zero. So now we apply the 0.7 was here zero. This is this is zero. Deviating. For classification, we'll see previous.
Ma'am, you are not audible.
So predicted value, this is totally this is converging towards the third category, not towards it cost entropy loss we are using, so it is giving 1 point. So far we are not doing anything with the loss, we are just identifying what is the loss. This is another example.
Ma'am, you are not audible.
For this, they are expected. Not audible. Once again. Now am I audible?
Yes, madam, you are audible.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, binary classification we are using software. This tells that even the losses are here, and this tells that my network has not converged, right? So we have loss, right? So that is the multi-class. So given weights, we know how to compute the model output for a given input. Given weights, we know how to compute the model's loss, right? So you know how to calculate the output, you know how to calculate the loss. So in both the case, a weight is given. So who will give the weight? How to calculate, how you get the weight? How will you initialize your network with the weight? That is another challenge, right? So for what challenges we try to solve? First, we saw what type of activation function we should use, why we should use a nonlinear activation function, and what activation function you are using in case of classification, and what type of activation function you should use in the output layer of binary classification. So all these and now how to give weight, right? Weight acts. So far we understand which trains your network, right? So how to give the weight, that is this thing, right? So who will give us the weight? That is a major constraint here. So who will give us the weight? Your learning algorithm has to give us the weight, right? So that learning algorithm we will see. Yeah, so I will take another example. Will I pass this class? For example, for this FTP, if the coordinator madam is keeping that, you will be getting certificate only if you attend. If you attend this many number of lectures, and if and at the end of the lectures, so if so, for example, will I pass this class? And let's start with. That is, these are all the two things, right? So whether I will be getting a certificate after completing this FTP, if any, all the participants are thinking, if this coordinator is telling that you have to attend this many hours out of these 2 weeks, if suppose each week 5 hours, so 5 into 10 days, right? So out of 50 hours, if you are attending only a minimum of 45 hours, then you will be given the certificate. And if a project, and for that project, you need to spend this much hour, only then the certificate is given. So if based on these two inputs, I know I wanted to know whether I will get the certificate or not, right? So if the number of lectures is more, And so here, this is I'm plotting this number of lectures you attend at the x-axis and the number of hours you spent on the final project after this FTP. This particular call, mean y-axis, and these are all the plots. So the green plots tells that I will be getting the certification, and the red plot tells that I will not be, because the number of hours I am attending the lecture is less and number of hours I am spending on the project is also less. So definitely I will not be getting the certificate. This is what that tells, right? So if any point here, definitely by seeing, I can tell that if for X1 is 4 and 5 hours of spending on final project, then definitely I will be getting the certificate, right? So this is, I'm giving 4 and 5 to the my network, and the actual, it should be 1, predicted is 0.5, whatever we saw in the previous. So here we will be calculating the loss, right? There are different, actually I shown only gross entropy loss. We have different types of loss calculation, only to show that I have taken this example. And how to calculate losses? Loss is nothing but the general simple way to calculate losses. Loss is a function of what? The predicted value, comma the actual value, right? This is a simple definition. What is loss? Loss is nothing but it is a function of predicted and the actual value, right? So how, there are different ways to calculate loss. One is empirical loss. Empirical loss is I want to calculate the total loss of the entire data set. This calculates only for a particular data set, right? Particular data set. I may be using cross entropy loss, or I may be using mean error square loss, and I will be calculating for a single input, right? If I'm going to take all set of input, for example, if I have 100 training data, for all the 100 training data, if I'm going to calculate the loss, then it is called as empirical loss, right? So the entire data set. So this is how you'll be calculating, right? So J of W, you will be calling it as a cost function or empirical risk or objective function. And and you will be calculating this, the predicted, right? This is for the all the values, right? All the for all the neurons, you will be calculating the loss, and then aggregation of that will give you the empirical loss, right? So empirical loss is for the entire data set, right? And next is cross entropy loss. That is what we saw. And this cross entropy loss can be used to model the output with the probability of 0 and 1, right? Wherever you have the probability of 0 and 1, there you can use cross entropy loss. That's what we saw there. And mean squared loss, excuse me. So mean square loss, so mean square loss is actually where you will be using this one is a binary cross entropy loss, or this is for multi-class classification. You will be using this one. That's what we saw here. And mean square loss, it calculates the and the mean value takes, right? And so that is, I mean, this one as well, where you can apply this mean square error is wherever you have the regression model, right? So what is regression model? Regression model, you all know, which gives a continuous output, right? For example, instead of just identifying whether I will be getting a certificate or not, if I want to predict my grade after the score, right? Based on this score, mean square error loss is continuous value instead of any abstract value, right? So these are all the different types of loss and visa, right? How to give the inputs, how to calculate the activation function, how to calculate the output value, and how to calculate the loss, right? How to calculate the loss. Based on the loss, how I am going to train the neural network, right? One way of the training the neural network is loss optimization. So what is loss of optimization is we want to achieve the lowest loss, right? So we have to reduce the lowest first loss, that is what is given, W star, that is loss, is equal to arg min. Arg min means is nothing but it is the minimum value. It should be the minimum value of among all these things, right? So when it is very, very minimum, then we will tell that the loss is optimized. So this minimum value can be equal to zero also. So how to measure the loss, right? What algorithm? This is our loss function of network. So I have plotted based on the weights, right? Based on weight W0, W1, I have plotted all my possible values, and this is the three-dimensional graph I have got, right? So now for any particular point in this, I need to use it to zero. That is, from, for example, if I am selecting a point here, that I should bring to the local least value, right? So when I try to reduce this, then I'm optimizing the loss, right? So what you will be using to optimize your losses, you will be using the gradient descent algorithm. So you all know what is gradient. Gradient is nothing but it calculates the maximum value, right? So I am actually picking a value here, a particular value. This is a random value picked here. A random value is picked here. And for this random value, I am trying to calculate the gradient. So always, you know, the gradient will be a largest value. So my task is to gradient, right? So what I will be doing is I will be moving the opposite direction of the gradient, because you all know that gradient is the largest value. My aim is to reduce the loss, so I need to travel in the opposite direction. And this I will be repeating until I come. So you will start with the highest value and you will try to reduce it until it converges to zero, or it converges to a very, very, very less value. After that, you will be having a saturation point. You will, for all the other things, it will be getting the same values, right? So that is what will be doing. And this is the algorithm. So you have to initialize the weight randomly. So how to compute the gradient? So you will be taking the partial derivative of total loss. JW is nothing but total loss with respect to weight, right? And then after calculating the gradient, what you will do is you will try to reduce the, that is, you try to update the weight, right? So how to update the weight? W is equal to W minus eta into the gradient. This is the gradient. Gradient is nothing but the differentiation of loss with respect to weight. With respect to weight that you are calculating, and this eta. What is this eta? Anyone? What is this eta? Box. Hope my voice is clear. Someone has quoted, ma'am, not clear voice.
It's clear, ma'am. Now it's clear.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Why it's coming? So, okay. So, just see and tell me what is eta. Anyone, please? Thank you. Voice is clear. What is eta? Eta is nothing but your learning rate. Like previously, you remember where we studied about tuning, parameter tuning, there we saw the learning rate eta, right? So eta is nothing but the learning rate. And afternoon session, we'll see how to keep the learning rate. When you compute loss, after computing loss, next what you have to do is, you have to differentiate that with respect to weight, and then you have to update and while calculating activation function till output, you are towards forward pass. You are moving, that is called as forward. what algorithm you apply. So this is me. So and given all the weights of our networks, how do you, which way to must, and you know all the weights of your network, how to proceed. So what algorithm we'll be using is, we'll be using backpropagation. Right, so we'll see how backpropagation lot. Okay, thank you. So see how backpropagation so you how a small change in the weight of the final loss we are going to see now, right? So we'll see, we'll take a thin neural network. So here you can see only one layer where this is the input, zi is the output, and y hat is the this is the hidden layer, right? So here what we are doing is we are calculating, move this window away from your shared application. How I should move, I don't know. Okay, so we'll see. This is how, okay, this is what is having w, so w1 then output jw and as well as the loss, right? So how to calculate the loss you are as we saw, you will be calculating with this loss d of jw, that is total loss with respect to weight w2, right? So when I want to represent with differentiate jw with respect to w2, what I will be doing is I will be applying the partial derivative. So why the term partial derivative is, I am not considering the entire weight, I am going to considering the weights labor by layer. So dou j of w divided by, so here I have y hat, so y hat into y hat w. So actually I am splitting this function, right? Dou that is partial derivative of jw by w2 into two different functions, right? That is dou jw divided by dou hat, right? Dou hat in that into dou hat into w2. So what is I am doing here is I am applying the chain rule. So what I am doing here is the purple color, this first derivative I am taking, and then I am multiplying with this particular thing, that is which is shown in the pink color, right? So that is what is done, and I need to travel till them here, I need to go back here. So how is that, yeah, what happened by w1, this I have j by dou y and dou y with res 1, right? So like this I will be, so again, y hat I am differentiating with respect, I am differentiating with respect to x. Hope it is clear. This is what happens in the backpropagation. This is how it is calculating the gradient, or it is, gradient is nothing but your differentiated value. This is how you will be calculating the, so repeat this for every weight in the network using gradient from the later layers, right? Whichever layer you are, it up to the first layer, it comes and calculates, and that is what happens in the back propagation. Hope it's clear. So the same thing I have shown here, right? Want time, I'm just skipping this, right? So our next is optimization. So we'll see how optimization is done. So I now how we'll see how the training neural network is difficult. So visualizing the loss in the landscape. So this is nothing but the loss, right? So that is what is given here. So we are how we are optimizing the loss function. One way to optimize the loss function is by using gradient descent, where you will be using eta. Eta is the learning rate, and this learning rate plays a major role, right? So the learning rate should be selected. The learning rate is an assumed value, and this should be selected in such a way that your network convergence fails, right? You cannot set this learning rate far high or the learning rate low, right? What happens if set in a, if it is not proper, we'll see in the false local maxima, and the large learning rate overshoot, and this then your network become unstable. Right? What do you mean the unstable is false set of training values, it gives a proper output. For another set of training samples, it will not give a proper output. So your network will not be stable, right? So when you want to have a stable network, then you have to select the learning above which should not be large or which should not be too small, right? So you will be selecting set. There are two ways that learning. To the landscape, that is